Right, I get to arise. You guys have to remain seated. I don't know if you remember, back in November during our Thanksgiving praise service, one of the testimonies said, and this is what stuck with me, one of the testimonies, the person said, you know what, the people are happy here, and I want to keep it that way, all right? Today, the sermon title is going to be, How Can I Deal with Anger and Personal Conflict? In the past 9 months, God has blessed this church. God has blessed this ministry. We've had 14 people join. 4 people have been baptized. And I rejoice in that. And, you know, more people are waiting in the wings. You know, they're on deck. They're planning to get into the membership here. But because the church family is growing, has grown, and because the larger a family gets, the more opportunities there are, the greater potential there is for miscommunication, for misunderstanding. So today, I'm veering off our regular course study of the Gospel of Mark, just as a pastoral touch on our congregation. I have no one particular in mind besides myself, and I'll give you some personal illustrations of how these misunderstandings occur. And so, again, as the church grows, I want to give you instruction on how to handle anger and how to approach the very concept or idea of anger in your personal life, and how I can deal with or handle personal conflict. Because what happens is, in our communication, sometimes there's miscommunication, then there's misinterpretation, which leads to misunderstanding, and misunderstanding can lead to anger, and anger can eventually lead to strained or broken relationships. All right, and so today we're going to look at what Jesus says about anger. And my desire, my heart's desire for the church is that each of us individually strives to do what Paul said, to exercise a conscience void of offense, you know, toward God, that vertical relationship, and toward men, that horizontal relationship. And I desire Psalm 133:1 for us. It says, "Behold, how good and how pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity." And so Matthew chapter 5 is our text this morning, beginning in verse 20. And Jesus deals with the topic of anger among family, among brethren. Here's just a couple of personal illustrations that I think, you know, sometimes communication can be misunderstood and misinterpreted. Circumstances and words can be misinterpreted, and it can give rise to certain emotions, unhealthy emotions at that. And those emotions lead to wrong thinking and then eventually wrong action. About a couple months ago, I was in the church office on a Thursday night, I believe it was, between 10 and 11 p.m. And I'm studying, I'm reading as I do. It's quiet, and I hear a pow. And a couple seconds later, pow. You know, it's like someone was breaking glass. And I figured, you know, somebody's driving along on the highway and threw a couple bottles out. And just I could hear the shattering of the bottles. And I'm like, you know, didn't worry about it. And then about 5 seconds later, pow, it wasn't a gunshot. It was just like a light bulb breaking. And I didn't know what it was, but, you know, at that time I was thinking, okay, there are my scissors. Here's my phone, 911. And I'm thinking, if they break through the glass doors, I've got another exit on the side of the church office. But that is what I'm thinking. And so I go and I look out the door. I had my phone in my hand, and I'm looking and nothing. So I'm like, it was probably just nothing. So I went back to my study. And the next morning, though, the chairman of our deacon says, "Hey, someone has broken or vandalized the globe lights in the entryway of our church driveways." Okay, you don't notice them during the daytime, but at nighttime they're good to use as a guide to pull in, so you don't drive into a ditch, right? But he said, "It looks like someone took a baseball bat to them." And that day, we were going as a Christian school. We were going to the Armed Services Museum. And, you know, on their way, I was on the bus thinking, man, who would do such a thing to a church? And I'm getting angry inside. And I'm determining in my head, you know, when I get back, I'm going to put on the church sign, the electronic sign, to the vandal who broke our parking lights, "We forgive you. But God would have you make restitution," you know. So I am getting angry as I think about this. And then I come back, I'm taking it personally. Here is a satanic attack on the church, preventing people from getting in and preventing the light to shine. And, you know, I'm spiritualizing it. I'm doing all these things. And I do call and file a police report. That very same day we got back from the field trip. And what happened? About a week later, I find out that somebody else's business lights just down the block were also broken or vandalized. Someone at the church works there right down the street. I'm like, And then about a month later in prayer meeting, a couple weeks later in prayer meeting, someone said that their farm light was destroyed. Someone took a BB gun and broke the farm light, the globe light. And then, you know, I felt a little relief. It wasn't just me in the church, right? But again, you can misread, you can misinterpret, and anger can result in actions follow, and that destroys relationships and testimonies. Another occasion here on a Wednesday night, and I mentioned it before here, but I had used an illustration about human nature and the nature of man, and I used a title of a spaghetti western, right? The good, the bad, I'm going to put my hands in front of my face, and the ugly, right? But during that Wednesday night sermon, I ended and looked at somebody when I ended on ugly. And that was not intentional, right? This person came to me and said, "Why did you end on ugly when you ended on me?" Right? And I'm like, that was an illustration. That was no intention. It was not a personal insult on my part toward your looks. But that's what I'm saying here. Okay, misunderstandings, miscommunications can lead to misinterpretations and misplaced anger and broken relationships. So my desire, again, through this sermon, is to help you to understand anger and to help you to understand how to biblically approach anger and resolving of personal conflict. All right, so turn to Matthew chapter 5. We'll begin in verse 20. How are we going to handle the anger which rises up in us? How are we going to settle personal conflicts? How should I approach that? But before I read the text, just remember now, Matthew 5, we're going to start in verse 20, go through verse 26. Jesus is speaking about how the Pharisees approach the law of God. And he was teaching that they were very concerned with obeying the external matters of the law. They followed in a very legalistic, wooden, and a joyless way. They followed the letter of the law, but they neglected the weightier matters of the law, love, truth, justice, that type of a thing, and they focused on external obedience rather than an internal change. So Jesus tells his disciples that the true meaning of the law, the true purpose of the law, and the kingdom living that I'm now going to produce or explain to you is not just about external obedience to God's word. It's about an internal change. It's the spirit of the law that needs to be followed as well as the letter of the law. In Matthew chapter 5, he'll list six comparisons about external performance of the law and an internal response to the law. He'll deal with anger, lust, divorce, lying, revenge, hatred, and he's calling on his followers to commit themselves to more than just external obedience. He's calling on his followers to allow the Spirit of God to change the heart that you might have the spirit of the law. This is what kingdom living is going to be about. And then he says in Matthew 5, verse 20, and we'll read it, and we'll go from there to verse 23. He says, "For I say unto you, that except your righteousness shall exceed the righteousness of the scribes and the Pharisees, ye shall in no case enter into the kingdom of heaven. You've heard that it was said by them of old time, Thou shalt not kill, and whosoever shall kill shall be in danger of the judgment. But I say unto you, that whosoever is angry with his brother without a cause shall be in danger of the judgment. Whosoever shall say to his brother, Raca, shall be in danger of the council. But whosoever shall say, Thou fool, shall be in danger of hellfire." So here Jesus is addressing the topic of anger in connecting it with the commandment of Thou shalt not kill, the sixth commandment of the Decalogue. How can I deal with anger? How am I to approach it? Well, according to what Jesus is saying here is that your righteousness is going to have to exceed the righteousness of the scribes and Pharisees. And the truth is, we can't. Internally, we cannot do it on our own. We're going to need a new heart and a new spirit within us to do so. And Jesus is teaching here that this righteousness is going to be, you're going to have the righteousness of God in order to follow the kingdom living that I am proposing. So the Old Testament law was designed to be a system of justice and mercy. Okay, there is external obedience, but the Pharisees and the religious leaders of the time were focusing on the external rather than the internal aspect of the law. Jesus was attacking that attitude. Okay, it's not just external obedience, but there has to be an internal approach to God and a relationship with God. And you have to have a new heart. You cannot do it on your own. So the basic concept here, when Jesus says, you have heard that it shall be said by them of old time, thou shalt not kill. Okay, the Jews knew what that meant. They knew that was in the Ten Commandments. They knew they were not supposed to kill or murder. But what they were doing was neglecting the other aspect of human relationship. Remember, the second half, Commandment 6 through 10, has to deal with your relationship with other people. Commandment 5 has to deal with your relationship of honoring your mother and your father. So they were doing the outside, the external, correctly, but they were forgetting that there is more to that than external. We know that murder was forbidden by God. They knew that. But did you know, Genesis 9:6, even before the Ten Commandments came, okay? Genesis 9:6 says, whoso sheds man's blood, by man shall his blood be shed, for in the image of God created he him, or man. So even before the Ten Commandments, the rule was established, if somebody destroys or kills or murders, that person, his life is going to be forfeit. And so we have that commandment in Exodus 20, verse 13, thou shalt not kill. Deuteronomy 5:17, thou shalt not kill. And then it's codified again in Exodus 20, verse 12, where what should you do to this person who kills? Exodus 20, verse 21, verse 12 says, he that smites a man so that he dies shall be surely be put to death. So externally, if you kill, you shall be killed. Okay, the capital punishment was the argument there. But the rule is, look, thou shalt not kill. You've heard them teach that. And it's accurate. Jesus wasn't saying that they were wrong. Jesus was saying that there's more to that. There's more behind that. There's a better way to understand that commandment other than, hey, I'm okay. I've never killed anybody, so I'm okay. I've kept that commandment. But Jesus is going to get to the root of the matter. When he says, you've heard that it was said by them of old time, thou shalt not kill, but I say unto you, Jesus is making an amendment. Jesus is trying to clarify and elevate the meaning of that commandment. The Pharisees, again, understood that law. They literally did not murder anybody, and so they thought, we're okay with God. In fact, in just a short amount of time, these Pharisees, which Jesus has just said, your righteousness is going to have to exceed their righteousness, but these Pharisees, in just a short amount of time, will get so angry at Jesus that they will plot his death. But they'll get somebody else to do it. And so their hands are clean. We didn't break that commandment. So Jesus is getting to the heart of the issue here. No longer could a person take pride in saying, I've never killed anyone. In fact, if you witness to people, and they will say this. You take them through the Ten Commandments, and they'll say, I've never killed anybody. It's saying, okay, I've kept that commandment. I'm righteous. But Jesus, again, will get to the heart of the issue. Jesus was teaching that people didn't have to. He was teaching that people did not need to be more righteous than the Pharisees by the number of commandments they kept. Jesus was teaching that the manner in which you keep the commandments is the issue. It's a heart issue and not just a behavioral external issue. Keep your finger here, but let's turn to Leviticus chapter 19, and I'll just give you an example. As Jesus is making these commandments and this teaching, in Leviticus chapter 19, verse 17 to 18, Jesus is, or the law is teaching us, that this is an internal matter. Yes, I would rather have somebody angry at me than kill me, right? That's always the case. I would rather live than get killed. But here, Jesus is going to get to the heart of the matter. In Leviticus chapter 19, beginning in verse 17, we have what the Pharisees will neglect in the teaching of the people. Okay, remember, these people didn't have mass market, Bibles in their hands, like the iPhones that we have today. They didn't even have the Biblos, the book that you have in your hand today. So they would hear continually from their religious leaders, you've heard that it's been said, but what they were leaving out, what they were distorting, what they were neglecting were the weightier matters of the law: truth, mercy, love, justice. Okay, look at Leviticus 19, verse 17. Thou shalt not hate thy brother in thine heart. Thou shalt in any wise rebuke thy brother and not suffer sin upon him. Look, if he's in sin, you've got to address it. Tell him. Verse 18, thou shalt not avenge nor bear any grudge against the children of thy people, but thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. I am the Lord. So yes, thou shalt not murder is important. And yes, the external obedience to that command is just, but even underlying that, hatred. You have to deal with hatred. You shouldn't hate your brother. In fact, if he's in sin, you need to rebuke him so he doesn't fall into further sin and judgment. In fact, you're not to let your anger reach the point of vengeance, because God will revenge you or avenge you. God will repay. So you've got to be on guard against anger. He was teaching that the law does not just reach only to the external matter of life, externalism, but the internal, the heart attitude towards men, the heart attitude that you have to a brother, a neighbor, a coworker, to a member in the church. What is your heart attitude? Jesus is getting to the root of the matter. And he was showing people that they are utterly unable. They're unable to keep the law without a right relationship with God. In order to keep the law as it was given, you have to have a right relationship with God. And so it's not enough that you stop at thou shalt not kill, but you must guard your heart against anger, lust, and all these other things. And you cannot do that apart from receiving a new heart and a new life and a new spirit within you. And so he warns us after this. You've heard that it was said by this, but I say unto you, verse 22a, the first part of verse 22 of Matthew 5, he warns against three forms of unrighteous anger. The first one is, but I say unto you that whosoever is angry with his brother without a cause shall be in danger of the judgment. Some of you who are reading different versions will notice that there's a phrase missing, without a cause. Now some will say, yeah, you know what? It's a given. It's an assumption that all anger has a cause, so it's not necessary to be in there. The authorized version has without a cause. If we were to read that statement without the phrase without a cause, it would seem like this, that it's wrong to ever be angry. And we know that's not the case, right? We know that's not the case. We know that Jesus was angry so much so that he took a whip and drove out the money changers and flipped the money changers' tables in the temple. In the house of prayer. Remember he said, you have turned my father's house, a house of prayer, into a den of thieves. Get out. Was he angry? I would say so. It doesn't say anger, but I believe he was. But in Mark chapter 3, verse 5, if you remember, Jesus is in the synagogue, and there's a setup there. There's a man that is placed there with a withered hand. The Jews, knowing that he would probably heal him on the Sabbath. And Jesus asked them this question. Is it right on the Sabbath to kill or to save life? Is it right on the Sabbath to do evil or to do good? And then Mark 3:5 says, because they did not respond, they held their peace. In Mark 3:5, it says that Jesus looked upon them with anger. And he said to the man, stretch forth thy hand, and the man did, and he was healed. So did Jesus express anger? Absolutely. Did the Apostle Paul say in Ephesians 4:26 and 27, be angry? Be angry and what? Sin not. Let not the sun go down on your wrath, neither give place to the devil. So there is such a thing as a righteous anger. But unrighteous anger, anger that has no cause, is going to put you in a place that is not welcoming. It's a place that you can get judged, okay? But let me define the word angry there as it's used in Matthew 5:22. The idea is a passive receiving of anger and bitterness. It refers to a seething, a simmering bitterness that is allowed to get worse rather than allowed to die on its own. So Jesus is saying, watch that, because it's going to lead to an unhealthy emotion, anger. That anger will lead to hatred, and hatred eventually will lead to violence or spiritual damage, spiritual harm, hurt feelings, strained or broken relationships, and ultimately, every murder starts in the heart because of anger. Even murder. So most people will say, you know what? I was okay to be angry. They will find a way to justify their sin. But if you read the scriptures, you'll see that anger is justified only when God's honor is at stake or when someone else is being wronged. It's never right to respond in an angry retaliation. Thessalonians says, render not evil for evil. Paul would write in Romans, be not overcome of evil, but overcome evil with good. So anger needs to be a righteous anger if it's going to be addressed. Your anger that rises up within you should be channeled to do that which is right and that which is good. Now he says, if you do get angry without a cause, he says you're in danger of the judgment. In other words, you'll be brought to the lower courts. And then he goes on to say in the next part of verse 22, after he says, if you're angry without a cause, he says, if you say to your brother, Raca, you shall be in danger of the council. Raca is a Chaldean or an Aramaic word that means an empty one, an empty head, a blockhead. It is a personal insult to someone's intelligence. It's as if we're calling somebody a brainless idiot or a worthless airhead in a spirit of anger. And he says, you do that, that verbal abuse which comes from an angry outburst, that verbal abuse puts you very near in danger, liable to the next form of judgment, the council. The council represents the Sanhedrin. It would be like the Supreme Court. So, you know, no anger without a cause leads to judgment in the lower courts. Calling somebody, verbally abusing somebody out of anger, you're going to, you know, you're in danger of being taken to the Sanhedrin, the council. And then in verse 22, the third part, he says, but whosoever shall say, thou fool, shall be in danger of hellfire. The word fool there is the Greek word moros, where we get our word moron. It's somebody who is dumb or stupid or blockhead, we would call them. It denies their spiritual worth. They are morally worthless, is what you're saying. And behind that, what you're saying is the God who made you, you're attacking the image of God in that person. The God who made you has done this. And so you are very near now the fire of Gehenna, the fire of hell. Okay, and that's the danger there. You know what, let me just give you an Old Testament example. I'm going to have to fly through some of this. Keep your finger here. Turn to Numbers. Turn your Bible to Numbers, and I'll just catch up the story here. Here's an Old Testament example. This word, mora, is believed to be a transliteration of the Hebrew word mora, okay? And this was used, I'll just summarize it instead of reading it, but Numbers chapter 20, verses 10 through 12, you can follow along. But God is telling Moses, you know, the people are complaining, we don't have water, we don't have food, and God says, take your rod, go to in front of the people, speak to the rock, and water shall come forth. So Moses takes his rod, goes before the people, and calls them, ye rebels, you fools. Shall I strike this rock? He was supposed to speak to the rock, and Moses, with his staff, strikes the rock, pound, pound, pounds it twice, and what happens? The water still comes forth, the people still get water, but God says, because you didn't sanctify me before the people, you will not enter into the promised land. There is a consequence for anger that's released that is unjust. So that's the word here, thou fool, thou rebel. Be careful, because you're very near God's very own judgment. The fires of Gehenna speaks of the valley that was on the south side of Jerusalem, where they would, you know, throw dead bodies who people wouldn't bury, where they would throw their city refuge, and there was a continual fire burning there. That location came to symbolize the ultimate punishment in hell for those who are unbelievers. So as we summarize this passage here, this angry verbal abuse reveals a heart that is far from God. Jesus, again, is focusing not on the outward act of murder, but on the inner heart and the anger and the bitterness that leads to murder. He was teaching that the law goes much further than the external behavior. We have to be ready to make things right, or else little disagreements, little quarrels will turn into gossip, slander, anger, and outright murder. You know, a spark of disagreement, if not tended to, can lead to a forest fire of hate and anger. Jesus, again, was teaching that unrighteous anger is incipient murder. What does that mean? Unrighteous anger is the embryonic form of murder. It is the beginning stages of murder. It is the root of murder. So let's nip it in the bud. Kill it before it grows. Manage it. Again, it's the root. In fact, if you don't believe me, the Apostle John, he was the apostle of love. He is the one that leaned on Jesus' chest, right, at the dinner table with the Last Supper. And in 1 John 3:15, that apostle writes this: whosoever hates his brother is a murderer. Now, those are strong statements. And you know that no murderer has eternal life abiding in him. So here's the question. How many of us have never hated anyone? Okay, you just drive on Business 19 for a week or two, and you will shout out maybe a couple of those words, raka and fool. Okay, how many of us have not hated anyone? Okay, and so we're, you know, if that is a continual practiced hatred, then you have to question whether you're saved or not, or at least people on the outside will. So you are guilty of hatred, and we have to come to the realization Jesus was destroying the Pharisees' self-righteousness. You can't live the life that I am prescribing for you on your own. You know, externally, yeah, you've never killed anybody, but guess what? If you didn't murder them in the act, you've murdered them in the heart. That's where murder comes from. It begins in the heart. Anger leads to hatred. Hatred leads to murder. If not in the act, it's in the heart. So I'm just going to quote a couple of verses for you in regards to the biblical teaching on anger. Ecclesiastes 7:9. Be not hasty in thy spirit to be angry, for anger rests in the bosom of fools. Ephesians 4:26. Be ye angry and sin not. Neither let the sun go down on your wrath. Don't let it begin to simmer. Don't nurture it. Deal with it. Right after that, he says, don't give place to the devil. Because what will the devil do? He will help you to simmer. And you know, every time you see that person that you're angry at, guess what? You will question everything they say. You'll question everything they do. You will question their motive. You will impute motive, which you don't know and can't read. Remember, man sees the outside. That's what the Pharisees were counting on. Man sees the outside, but God sees the heart. And so you have to deal with the heart issue of anger, or else it will grow. And according to Hebrews chapter 12, it says, live peaceably with all men. Pursue peace with all men and holiness. A couple verses down, he'll say, lest a root of bitterness grows and it defiles many. So you have to nip it in the bud, kill it at the root, address the anger. One way or another, but the one way that God prescribes we have here, deal with it. And he'll say how and why in the next passage here. Let's go back to Matthew 5, verse 23. Let me read you a paraphrase as we go back to Matthew 5 of what we just read, okay? William Barclay says this: what Jesus is saying in this passage here, that in the old days men condemned murder, and truly murder is forever wrong. But I tell you that not only are a person's outward actions under judgment, the inmost thoughts are also under the scrutiny and the judgment of God. Long-lasting anger is bad. Contemptuous speaking is worse. And the careless or the malicious talk which destroys someone's good name is worst of all. The one who is a slave of anger, the one who speaks in the accent of contempt, the one who destroys another's good name, may never have committed a murder in action, but that one is a murderer at heart. And that's the issue. Deal with the murder at the heart level. In other words, deal with anger at the heart level. Jesus will go on to say that reconciliation, dealing with this person that you're angry with, must proceed before worship. In other words, you cannot be right with God and be wrong with man. You cannot be right with God and have something wrong with man. You have to address it. It's that serious. Because all that you do means nothing if you come and lift your hands and sing praises unto God and you haven't dealt with the human relationships. That worship that you give is unacceptable. Let's read what Jesus says as he uses the illustration in Matthew 5:23. Therefore, if thou bring thy gift to the altar, and there rememberest that thy brother hath aught against thee, leave there thy gift before the altar and go thy way. First be reconciled to thy brother, and then come and offer thy gift. So he gives this example here. Two commands regarding personal reconciliation. Okay, there's a difference between forgiveness and reconciliation. Reconciliation requires two, right? It takes two to tango. It takes two to be reconciled. Forgiveness, on the other hand, may be extended, but the person who is offended has to receive it, accept it, and forgive in order for their two parties to be reconciled. And so he is saying here, before you come and offer up sacrifices, it's that important. Don't offer up your sacrifice. Leave your sacrifice at the altar. Go your way and first be reconciled unto your brother. And then, once that horizontal relationship is dealt with, then you can come and have a vertical relationship and offer up acceptable praise and worship. This is in regards to personal reconciliation. The idea here is someone is angry at you. You know, because of maybe something you said, something you've done, or maybe something you did not say and did not do, has offended this person and they're angry and you know it. God is saying, deal with it. You have to deal with it. It's more important than you obeying and offering up sacrifices. Okay? No man can be right with God and wrong with his brother. Jesus is just repeating what has been constantly taught throughout the Old Testament. Remember the issue with King Saul and the prophet Samuel? Saul is impatient and waiting for Samuel to come, and instead of waiting for Samuel to come and make the offering, Saul does it himself. And then the response that Samuel has, he says in 1 Samuel 15, "Hath the Lord as great delight in burnt offerings and sacrifices as in obeying the voice of the Lord? Behold, to obey is better than sacrifice, and to hearken than the fat of rams." Look, it's more important for you to obey than to come and worship and have offer sacrifices. You need to be obeying. And if there's something wrong between you and your brother, it needs to be addressed. You have to take care of it. Now, Micah would say the same thing, and without me reading the entire passage, Micah lists a litany of things that you can do as worship. You can offer up thousands of rams. You can offer up 10,000 of rivers of oil. You can offer up all these things. And you know what he says? Really, they mean nothing unless you do this. Micah 6:8. He has showed you, a man, what is good. What does the Lord require of you? But to do justice, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with God. So, before you offer up sacrifices, knowing that you are wrong with your brother in some way, go deal with it. Obey his commandments to be right with your brother before you come and offer up sacrifice. Matthew 18:15, beginning in verse 15, Jesus begins the teaching on church discipline. But the first step here, how do I deal with this? If I know my brother is angry at me, what do I need to do? Don't offer up the sacrifices. Go to the brother one-on-one. Matthew 18:15 says, "Moreover, if your brother shall trespass against you, go your way. Tell him his fault between you and them, you and him alone. If he hears you, you've gained a brother." So go take care of it one-on-one. Deal with anger. Deal with the offense. And you can do what Paul has done here. You have strived. You are reaching forth, endeavoring to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace, that we as a church might experience that blessed atmosphere of love, enjoying the love and forgiveness of God, and also enjoying the love and the forgiveness of brothers. That is the goal. And we have to work towards this. And he ends with this other illustration, and I'll be done here. He says, take this example, okay? Imagine that somebody is going to take you to court. And typically what happens, I owe somebody money. The plaintiff takes me, the defendant, to court. And Roman law, Roman practice was, you guys can be walking all the way up to the courthouse, and you can settle the issue before you get in to see the judge. And he's saying, do that. Do that quickly. You need to take care of it, because if you don't, let me read back up to Matthew 5, 25. Agree with your adversary quickly while you're in the way with him, lest at any time the adversary deliver thee to the judge, and the judge deliver thee to the officer, and thou be cast into prison. Verily I say unto you, thou shalt by no means come out thence until thou hast paid the uttermost farthing. He's saying, you'll probably lose, and you're going to pay for it. In fact, a debtor, if he doesn't have the money to pay the debt, is going to be cast into prison. And in prison, he cannot work to pay off his debt, and so he's going to be in debt for a long, long time. So, meet with the one who has aught against you. Deal with it immediately so that you are not cast into prison, so that you don't experience the wrath of the judge. Take care of it right now. Now, just like salvation, right? Now is always the time for salvation, and now is always the time for reconciliation. Reconciliation, the time for it, now. Here and now. In fact, even before you worship and offer your sacrifice. So in the end here, don't let things fester. Get to it. There is no question that people can rub you the wrong way. You know, I laugh because of the different personalities in the church. And you know, some get along, some don't get along. But they're still cordial and friendly and loving. And we all agree on each other's gifts, and we support and love and encourage one another. But there are times when, you know, there's just some people that rub you the wrong way. Their speech, their mannerisms can be frustrating, irritating, even infuriating. You know, the song, the hymn, I can't remember it now, but it has to do with the Church of God moves forward. To live below with those we know, oh, that will be glory. Okay, I've messed it up. I didn't write it down, so I'll have to repeat it some other time. But it's living with people that we know and their shortcomings and how they rub you the wrong way, yet still having a spirit of love, forgiveness, without letting anger fester and boil and bitterness grow in so much that it comes out in an angry outburst. So again, the time for reconciliation is now. Settle it before you go into court. Because what happens if you do take somebody to court? You may win the court case, but the relationship is destroyed. That will not be restored. And the testimony of Christ in the church is going to be tainted, stained. So deal with the outburst. Deal with the anger. Deal with it before judgment comes, and deal with it before God's judgment comes on you to chasten you, to discipline you, because you did not discipline yourself. So what sins here, as I close, have you committed against a brother? Okay, here's some self-inventory time. Do you need to confess and seek forgiveness from someone? Can you say those humbling yet spirit-filled, spirit-liberating words? Here it is. I was wrong for doing this, this, and this. I sinned against you. Please, will you forgive me? That's on the offender side. Now, if you're on the offended side, maybe it is you who needs to forgive. Maybe it's you who needs to be able to say, when that brother confesses, I forgive you. That is when separation brings a oneness again. Forgiveness is extended and received. That is God's will for you, for the church. Forgiving others and asking forgiveness is very near, is very really never easy, but by God's grace it is possible. When we seek forgiveness, when we grant forgiveness, we are being like God. We express the love of Christ through this act of forgiveness. And then in the end, we can receive Psalm 133:1, "Behold, how good and how pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity." And that's my goal, that's God's goal, that's my goal for the church, it's God's will for you as well.